So, Dr. Tilman Lüttke ist unser letzter Moderator heute Abend, hat lange auch ausgeharrt. Ich hoffe, es war trotzdem auch spannend für Sie. Ich möchte ihn ganz kurz vorstellen. Er hat in Freiburg Islamwissenschaft, neue Geschichte studiert und war dann in Syrien, Ägypten, ging 1993 nach England, wo er dann in Oxford den Master gemacht hat. Dann hat er 1,5 Jahre in Istanbul verbracht, hat eine Promotion danach in Oxford begonnen und im Jahr 2001 abgeschlossen, hat danach 2 Jahre in Nordzypern gearbeitet und ist jetzt seit, wann genau, seit 2009 am Arnold-Bergstrasser-Institut in Freiburg als Senior Researcher für den Bereich Nahe und Mittlerer Osten spezialisiert. Herzlich willkommen, Herr Dr. Lüttke, vielen Dank, dass Sie da sind. Hier rechts von mir ist Ken O'Keefe, er ist aus London mit Gilad Azmon im Auto angereist. Sami Habib auch, habe ihn heute Morgen schon kurz erwähnt, ist gebürtig aus Gaza und lebt aber auch mit seiner Frau in London. Dann übergebe ich an Herrn Dr. Lüttke und dann geht's weiter.
Ja, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, mir ist die leidvolle Aufgabe zugefallen, einem erschöpften Publikum das letzte Panel präsentieren zu müssen. Darum mache ich es kurz. Zu meiner Linken sitzt der erste unserer Sprecher, Sami Habib. Er ist Journalist aus dem Gazastreifen gebürtig, hat während des israelischen Krieges gegen Gaza 2009 als Berichterstatter für Dutch TV, als freier Journalist bei Al Jazeera, BBC, Channel 4 und Sky News gearbeitet, war dort auch als Fotograf tätig und hat seine Arbeit in einer Vielzahl von Print- und Online-Medien veröffentlicht. Sein Thema ist hauptsächlich Palästina und regionale Themen im Mittleren Osten und er ist ein erfahrener Vortragender auf vielen Konferenzen und Workshops, unter anderem in Australien, Europa und Südafrika. Seine Online-Zeitung trägt den Namen The Palestine Telegraph. Das Thema von Herrn Habib lautet schlicht und einfach Fakten und Erzählungen aus Gaza und damit möchte ich ihm das Wort erteilen.
Good evening everyone. I really have the very tough job along with Ken. We are speaking after a few hours. As you know, most of us are tired, but hopefully we'll be able to speak and you will not be that tired this time. For my presentation, I'd like to thank Gabby. Anne and all those organizers, Gilad and others, who really endured all these hassles and harassments from those so-called anti-Zionists. Thanks for your efforts, and hopefully the evaluation of the people would be positive, and I think my Owen evaluation is very positive. Today I'd like to speak about Gaza Strip. As you know, most of the speakers spoke on various topics. It was somehow dry to some people, it was sometimes academic, but I'll speak about some of the events that happened in the Gaza Strip. And I'll be speaking about the siege in the Gaza Strip as well as the war. Hopefully, I would not be very boring this time. So I'll go with the first slide, and I prefer really if I could do it myself, so I could control if you don't mind. I know, okay. I could move the laptop, can I? Okay, that's right. It looks good. Okay, so as you know, there has been a siege for almost 4 years now, 5 years, as we approach 2012. So the outline of the presentation quickly is about health, industry, agriculture, construction infrastructure, crossing and freedom of movement. These are the main topics of my presentation. As we speak about the health sector, there are more than 850 people who died, or in a way or another, sentenced to slow death within the Gaza concentration camp, as the Israelis neither allowed the needed medications for them, nor allowed them to leave for medications in Jordan or in elsewhere worldwide. There is a great medicine shortage till this moment. The cast that happened, there was a problem for the world. The problem is still there. We have a shortage of more than 150 medications, as well as medical equipment, as well as medical machines. Also, we have the problem of the intimidation, as we have some people from the Gaza going to go to get some treatment within Israel hospital, they will be encountering a very cheap process, or a better process, in which they would be intimidated, in which would be offered to work with Israelis to get information, and we have many case studies. As you see in the picture on the top, on the right, the guy called Nail, he has a unique story. He showed up on the TV, and his story was a few weeks before he died. He showed up on the TV and he said, "Look, I'm having a cancer. I'll be dying soon. I have to cross Israel and to go to one of the Israeli hospitals to get a treatment." He was denied exit from Gaza. He then died a few weeks. And the pretext always is security threat. Imagine a guy with a cancer is a security threat for Israel. It's not only him, this woman as well. She was having a problem as well, a chronic disease. She was not allowed to leave Gaza. She showed up on the TV, made her call. No one listened to her. And after a week or 2 weeks, she died. This is the baby for us. And he was on Al Jazeera. This is a widely watched story. This guy was not allowed to leave Gaza. And Israelis gave him the permission 1 hour after he died. And these are some of the harrowing pictures that we've managed to get from our online newspaper, the Palestine Telegraph. These are recent photos for those children. And as you see, it looks as if it's depleted uranium after the casket. It was a year after the casket, and we don't know what would happen next. Education and the schools in the Gaza Strip. As you know, we've been passing a siege for years now. Within that siege, Israelis were not allowing the needed materials for the education system, like stationery and all other requirements. Also, when the war happened, they have destroyed around 250 schools, either partially or entirely. Until this moment, Israelis are not allowing any kind of raw materials to get into the Gaza Strip. From time to time, they are allowing some few trucks of raw materials to get to the owner, and this is for the purpose of only propaganda. So to speak about the economy, as you know, we are totally linked with the Israeli economy. We don't have any kind of independence. Everything is relied Israeli on the Israelis. Any kind of imports or exports, it has to be arranged with the Israelis. Most of the raw materials we have are imported from Israel, and sadly we don't have that chance to boycott. Maybe you have the chance and you're making these big campaigns about the BDS. But in Gaza we don't, we are allowed to have their bullets, their rockets, and also their food stuff. There are 4,000 factories in Gaza closed, as well as many workshops. Poverty rates more than 80%, unemployment rate more than 67%. You can, as I said, import but never export. And the Israeli attacks on the Palestinian industrial facilities are still taking place. As we speak about the agricultural sector, it is totally destroyed, and Israelis have launched their own campaign to create a no-man zone on the very fertile agricultural lands on eastern Gaza Strip. Fishing, as you know, is only allowed for a few miles off Gaza shores, in which any fisherman would try to get in would be shut out, or would be killed, or would be taken as a prisoner. And maybe King could tell you more about this, where he experienced some of the tricks with the fishermen. As we speak about the construction, and infrastructure in Gaza, it is totally really destroyed. On time of siege, within the war, and after the war, until this moment. We have a water crisis in Gaza. Thousands of people in remote villages in Gaza Strip cannot get clean water. They have to go for some distance to get some fresh water or to use some old ways. Spare parts are not allowed to water facilities from time to time for propaganda purposes. And to say there is no humanitarian crisis in Gaza, as Danny Aaron always says, they allow some spare parts to get into the Gaza Strip. Sewage water is also a problem in the Gaza Strip. There's more than 77 million of sewage water is leaking on a daily basis into the Mediterranean, because we cannot treat the sewage water there. We cannot have the materials, as Israelis are not allowing these in. There's a fuel ban and oil problem as well, but as you know, we're getting the fuel now from Egypt. But 3 years ago, we were not able to run any cars in the Gaza Strip. And maybe you remember that we were using the cooking oil to run and operate the cars in Gaza. Maybe we learned how to be innovative from the Germans, I think. crossings and freedom of movement, as you see, these photos are typical photos of what is happening on a Rafah crossing. And these photos are still taking place till this moment, although these photos are old. Gaza has 70 crossings. I guess one of them is closed, two of them are closed now, while the rest are with Israel and one with Egypt. And although the revolution happened in Egypt, the problem is still there. There is the Amn al-Dawla, the security state apparatus in Egypt. They have lists of thousands of Palestinians in the Gaza Strip, including me. We were not allowed to leave Gaza Strip. I'm a security listed person where I cannot travel in and out of Gaza. I have to have a special coordination, either to pay or to leave it through the intelligence coordination, which I've done many times in a way or another. So the tunnels, we have more than 1,500 tunnels. More than 300 victims died within these tunnels while trying to build the new tunnels or smuggle foods into the Gaza Strip. And as I wrote, passengers travel, and I guess one of the people here you know, has a story, I guess one of the relatives have gone to Gaza. So the massacre, I don't know what is left for me, but I would be not that long. Nowhere is safe, that's the experience that we had in the Gaza Strip. It was around 11 a.m. in the morning. I was going out with my friends. We were planning to make a music concert to challenge the Israeli siege in the Gaza Strip. And quickly, we didn't speak about that topic. We were met with the Israeli bombardment, and it was really horrible. It was really scary to hear the loud bombings of the F-16s, more than 50, and maybe this or more, I cannot say. They were all bombing the Gaza city, and especially the compound of Al-Jawazat, central Gaza city. I was in that area. I tried to go there, and I passed by Al-Shifa Hospital, and I've seen the calamity of how people were slaughtered, of how the blood was all over the place, how the limbs were all over the place, and how the place in Al-Shifa Hospital was busy with those people. Within the time of war, there was no shelters, no enough food, no enough power, no enough water, fuel, and basic medications. As you know, they have attacked the United Nations. Gilad will tell you how low is Israel as a state. They don't abide by any international laws. They have attacked the schools where the people took refuge. Also, they have attacked many of the UN drivers. As you remember, maybe Sevin Ibni said that we have allowed some trucks of food that day, but they have killed the drivers of the UNRWA who tried to get these trucks. As you see in the photos, they have really riot many places. They have targeted schools, homes, hospitals, ambulances, clinics, streets, and more than this. Some quick stories. This is the story of Khaled Abu Trouble. I met him and I took these photos. This guy has his family slaughtered in a cold blood. The Israelis came to his town. Then they asked this guy to stay in the house. He stayed in the house. Then they asked this guy, along with his family, to go out and to leave the area. As he started to leave the area, the Israelis opened the fire. They shot his mom in the back, and then his daughter was shot dead, his two daughters. As he tried to rescue them, a man with a horse came to rescue those guys, but then this man, as well as the horse, were killed by the Israelis. And that's the story of Al-Samouni. We were really massacred, and I will leave this story for Ken. I could speak further about this. That's the story of Lu'ay. As you know, in time of war, people try to get shelter. Those people, and according to the Israeli instructions in the northern areas of the Gaza Strip, left their area into another safer areas in Gaza City. As they left their home into Jabalia, they've lived in a temporary school. As they hear that there was a ceasefire for 3 hours, they went back in the car to bring some of their needs from their homes. Yet the Israelis bombarded their car, and this guy got blinded, and some of his family members were killed. It's not only about people of Gaza, and this shows how criminals and cruel the Israelis are. These photos I've taken in other areas of the Gaza Strip. Those cows were not really bombed by F-16s, they were killed by snipers. And this shows the morality or the code of ethics that the Israeli army possesses. Even birds, this is in the area of El Samoni, they have built those, an entire farm with more than 16,000 chickens. And the media coverage, I don't want to speak more about the media coverage, I guess you are already have knowledge about how the media is biased to Israel. Maybe I have to link it in a few minutes quickly with my experience. This was in the Gaza Strip. As I came to London, I tried to make some workshops speaking. Well, I was a little, maybe person, 23 years old, 3 years ago. And I started to speak about my own experience. And then I started to get the harassments and the hassles of the Zionists in London. They tried to silence me many times. And I have a unique story that I would like to share with you, which is the story of Harness Jimmy Tong. I have this Palestine Telegraph Online newspaper. I got some patrons to be with us so we get some more credibility, because I'm a newly come out to the area, to London. So she agreed and she became, along with George Galloway, Louisa Morgantini and others, they became the patrons within my paper. We have taken, and here is the story, we have taken a story from Haaretz about the organs theft from Ukraine, and then another story from Stephen Lindman, a Jewish writer in the US, about the organs theft in Haiti. And the problem started, all the Israeli websites in the UK started to cover that issue. And then they started to pressure on Jenny Tong. They have made an interview with Jenny Tong and with me. Jenny Tong, for sorry, she said, IDF has a long history of crimes and they should really investigate whether this happened in Haiti or not. And I said, when they interviewed me, this is the view of the guy, it represents him, not me. And straight ahead, Nicky Clegg, the Deputy Prime Minister in the UK, pushed Prime Minister Jenny Tong to resign from her job as a Shadow Minister that time. Then she stayed with us until later she was pushed to quit the Palestine Telegraph, and we were nearly on all the mainstream media. This shows how the censorship is being there in the UK. This is my little small experience I had, and the conference was speaking about the boundaries today. I feel that really I'm not having this freedom of expression. As you know, maybe some of you think that the Arabs do not really have the freedom of expression there. So I came to London to experience this freedom of expression. And sadly, I'm not having this freedom of expression. I'm thinking maybe to come to Germany, maybe you have a space for me and I will be speaking loudly, hopefully. I guess this is my presentation. I would leave you here because I spoke a lot. Thanks for giving me the chance, and hopefully I will be able to come here again. Thanks.
Vielen Dank für Ihre sehr interessante und sehr bedrückende Präsentation.